A reading from the book of Exodus. Thus says the Lord, you shall not molest or oppress an alien. For you were once aliens yourselves in the land of Egypt. You shall not wrong any widow or orphan. If ever you wrong them and they cry out to me, I will surely hear their cry. My wrath will flare up, and I will kill you with the sword, then your own wives will be widows and your children orphans. If you lend money to one of your shall not act like an extortioner before him, biting any interest from him. If you take your neighbor's cloak as a pledge, you shall return it to him before sunset. For this cloak of his is the only covering he has for his body. What else has he to sleep in? If he cries out to me, I will hear him, for I am compassionate. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Silence the Sadducees. They gathered together, and one of them, the scholar of the law, tested him by asking, "Teacher, which commandment in the law is the greatest?" He said to them, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the greatest and the first commandment. The second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. The whole law and the prophets depend on these two commandments." The Gospel of the Lord.
You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the greatest and the first commandment. The second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. Loving your neighbor as yourself is at the heart of Christian love. And anyone who has ever tried Christian love knows that that's no easy task sometimes. In the Gospel of John, Jesus tells his disciples that the one who loves is the one who lays down his life for his friends. In fact, the Apostle St. Paul says that all of the commandments can be summed up in the one commandment to love. St. Paul also spoke of some of the well-known commandments we find in the Old Testament. Do not murder, do not steal, do not covet, do not commit adultery. And he said that these and all the other commandments can be summed up into one. Love your neighbor as yourself. Now, many of us have heard this phrase so often, it has almost lost its meaning. Too often we hear it and we think it means only to be nice to people or not to hurt other people. Love your neighbor as yourself. When we hear this, we should consider three questions. How do we love? Who is our neighbor? And how do we love ourselves? The first question, how do we love, can be a very tricky one in our society, where we often act as though love is simply a warm emotion or a sudden sensation. We say that we feel love, or we don't feel love for another person. We may fall in love, or we may fall out of love. When it comes to romance, people usually don't choose who they love. They either feel it or they don't. They can't do anything about it either way. At least this is what our society would tell you. But Christian love has never been about simply feeling love. That's because Christian love is always tied to God's love, because God first loved us. Because Christ loved us enough to become one of us and to allow his love for humanity to lead him to the cross, to die and to rise again. Because of that love from God, we can love others. As such, we see others as God's children, as those for whom Christ also died, and we want them to know God's love. So therefore, we share our love with them, even when we don't particularly feel like it. Anyone who has ever had children knows about this type of love. Every parent has had days when they don't feel very loving toward their children, such as when their kids are making poor decisions, when they're engaging in actions that hurt themselves or others, when they're doing those things that just make a parent shake his or her head in frustration or sorrow. Yet it's at those times when a parent's love is the most needed, not just a feeling of love, but an attitude of love and a solid commitment. In the same way, we all know that as human beings, we do things that make it very difficult for God to feel loving towards us. When we hurt ourselves, or we hurt others, or we deny our Heavenly Father, love must be hard for God to feel towards us. But we have a great God. Even in those moments of God's greatest disappointment with us, God still loves us. Even in those moments, Jesus still overcame death on the cross for us. Sometimes we seem to do everything we can to make ourselves unlovable, but God still loves us. And because God has first shown love for us, we are then able to turn and share that love with others, helping to lead them to God's love for them. We love others by sharing the gifts that God has given to us, even when we don't feel very loving. The question that many of us also wonder about is, who is my neighbor? Now, in Jesus' time, your neighbor was not just the person who happened to live down the street from you, but all the members of your tribe, your race, or your nation. But in Jesus' teaching, it becomes clear that our neighbor is anyone with whom we have relationship. The commandment to love your neighbor means to be in good relationship with other people. Now, we could simply lock ourselves in our houses and rarely come out, and in that way, we would not succeed. We would not harm our neighbors, but we wouldn't be in relationship with them either. We couldn't really say that we love our neighbors in that case. So our neighbors are those with whom we are already in relationship, but loving our neighbor also calls us into new relationships, even though those whom we might not particularly care for or even be comfortable with. When someone asked this question of Jesus, who is my neighbor, his response was to tell a story about the Good Samaritan. A Jewish man had been beaten up by robbers and left for dead, lying out on a road. Nobody would help him until finally a Samaritan, a traditional enemy of the Jewish people, dared to cross the road, entered into relationship with that man, took care of him, and truly loved him. Other people did not treat the injured man as their neighbor. So the refugee, the abuse survivor, the kid that gets bullied at school, each one of them is our neighbor, and we are called to find ways to enter into relationships with them and to love them as our neighbor. Not simply by not harming them, because the people who walked on the other side of the road from the injured man didn't harm him, but by loving them as a neighbor. We can do this because of what God has given to each of us. God chose to enter into relationship with us through the person of his Son, Jesus. And every right relationship that we have with others is modeled after our relationship with Jesus Christ. God loved us through relationship, allowing us to love others through relationship with them. This is one of the amazing things about our God. Rather than simply giving us a list of do's and don'ts and telling us to try to figure out how to live that, which is what so many philosophers have done over the centuries, Christ chose to come to us and to show us how to live in relationship and in love with one another and with God. And this is really the answer to the question, how do we love ourselves? Now, we are constantly told by society and by advertising that we need to be more attractive or wealthy or popular or successful in order to really be loved. But we know as Christians that God already loves us. We don't need to be more of anything to be loved by our Father God. We have been created by Him, and God has declared each one of us worthy of love. And because God is so generous in giving us His very abundant love, we are then able to generously give that love to others. We see this in the simple phrase, love your neighbor as yourself. Love is not simply a feeling. Love is not simply do's and don'ts. Love is not simply doing no harm to someone else. And love is not simply doing good things for only those people that we like. Christian love is more than all those things. Christian love is more than what we do or say or believe. Christian love is a way of life. And what an amazing witness to the world we can offer when we live that life of love. God loves each one of us, and therefore we can share his love with others. Brothers and sisters, let us profess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten not made. As servants of the living God, our Savior, our Rock, our Mighty Help, let us turn to him in humble prayer.
For the Church, our Mother and Teacher, guiding us to live according to the two great commandments, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For leaders in government who love and serve their neighbors, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For widows and orphans and poor folks who cry out for justice, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For apostles of charity and community service, groups in our community, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the sick, especially Ralph Johnson, and for all those listed in the bulletin, we pray.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have died, especially Mary Ryan and Lisa Barber, and for the people of the parish for whom this Mass is being celebrated, we pray.
Grant our prayers, Father, for we strive to love you as we love one another, taught by your only Son, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Look, we pray, O Lord, on the offerings we make to your majesty, that whatever is done by us in your service may be directed above all to your glory through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your
spirit. Lift up your hearts.
Lift up the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is
truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Creator of the world and source of all life. For you never forsake the works of your wisdom, but by your providence are even now at work in our midst. With mighty hand and outstretched arm, you led your people Israel through the desert. Now, as your church makes her pilgrim journey in the world, you always accompany her by the power of the Holy Spirit and lead her along the paths of time to the eternal joy of your kingdom through Christ our Lord. And so with the angels and saints, we too sing the hymn of your glory as without end we acclaim. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. You are indeed holy and to be glorified, O God, who love the human race and who always walk with us on the journey of life. Blessed indeed is your Son, present in our midst, when we are gathered by his love, and when, as once for the disciples, so now for us, he opens the scriptures and breaks the bread. Therefore, Father most merciful, we ask that you send forth your Holy Spirit to sanctify these gifts of bread and wine, that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, on the night of the Last Supper, he took bread and said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, gave you thanks, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. The mystery of faith. We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again. Therefore, Holy Father, as we celebrate the memorial of Christ your Son, our Savior, whom you led through his passion and death on the cross to the glory of the resurrection, and whom you have seated at your right hand, we proclaim the work of your love until he comes again, and we offer you the bread of life and the chalice of blessing. Look with favor on the oblation of your church, in which we show forth the paschal sacrifice of Christ that has been handed on to us, and grant that by the power of the Spirit of your love, we may be counted now and until the day of eternity among the members of your Son, in whose body and blood we have communion. And so, having called us to your table, Lord, confirm us in unity so that together with Francis, our Pope, and Edward, our Bishop, with all bishops, priests, and deacons, and your entire people, as we walk your ways with faith and hope, we may strive to bring joy and trust into the world. Remember our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the peace of your Christ, and all the dead whose faith you alone have known. Admit them to rejoice in the light of your face, and in the resurrection give them the fullness of life. Grant also to us, when our earthly pilgrimage is done, that we may come to an eternal dwelling place and live with you forever, there in communion with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her most chaste spouse, with the apostles and martyrs, with Saint Benedict, and with all the saints, we shall praise and exalt you through Jesus Christ, your Son. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Thank you.
May your sacraments, O Lord, we pray, perfect in us what lies within them, that what we now celebrate in signs, we may one day possess in truth. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Just a few announcements. Please be sure to take the bulletins that are in the pews. Those are for you to take home to keep abreast of what's going on here in the parish. Also, there are offering baskets in the church at both exits. Please be generous to your parish during this difficult time. And finally, in terms of confession, this evening it will be held from 7:30 to 8 o'clock. And also, tomorrow it will be from 11 o'clock to 11:45. So please make yourself available for the Sacrament of Reconciliation. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May all